How about that? Matthew chapter 16. Let's go there. I know some of you are like, time out, one song's not enough. All right, what's going on? We're changing some things around. We're gonna try some things different. Let me tell you what the rest of the year is going to look like. We are starting this series today called Rethinking the Church. And we're gonna push some buttons, I think, a little bit. But I'm hoping that we can come back to God's Word and kind of all be on the same page as to what our expectations are for church and how we can think about it properly and biblically. And then we will roll right into a series that we're calling Set Apart, but it's a focus on holiness and how holiness is ultimately what leads to happiness, not the other way around. And then we'll be in Christmas, which is kind of crazy if you think about that. Of course, that's true if you're in Cracker Barrel too, so Christmas is already here. And all of that is to prepare us for 2019. And so we want to have some conversations over the next weeks looking towards next year. So we as a staff and elders, we got together, we asked some hard questions, we pointed to things that we have been doing for a long time, asked if we should keep doing them, and some things we killed. Some things we're going to make better. Some things we're going to start fresh, right? And to bring back that we used to do a long time ago. And some things that the new things we're going to try. We'll talk about some of this stuff today, but I'm hoping you guys will stick with us and come every week for the next couple weeks, because this topic is extremely important for us as a body of believers, but also looking forward to the coming years and next year specifically. We established a goal, and it's always a goal because we're always wanting to preach the gospel. It's more of a personal goal for me, but just through our efforts and the community, through our understanding of the importance of going and making disciples and going out and preaching the word of God, that we would see 100 new converts by the end of 2020, and we have 21 so far. So it's awesome. And it's really exciting, but we're not done. We got a long way to go, because the growth strategy, the marketing strategy of the church is not people coming from other churches. That's not how we want to grow. And what we do as a people to pour into each other, but also to fulfill the call that God has put on our hearts. And what does that really look like? So there's a lot of big questions that we've been asking to think about. A lot of things that we feel like we have done well, things that we think we can do better. And so several things that are coming up that we're going to introduce and talk about over the next few weeks. We're going to dig into this question over the next couple weeks on what is the church, right? What is the church supposed to be? What does the Bible say it is? What have we learned maybe in the past that we're holding on to that we need to let go of so that we can come back to the biblical description of church? And if I were to take a poll, I almost did it live, and maybe I don't know, I'm tearing with myself right now because I almost want to just ask the questions. You know what? I'm just going to do it. I'm going to ask the questions. Here we go. If I were to ask you, what you expected from your church, what are some things you would say? Acceptance, right? Okay. A fellowship, sense of community, and that's good. Anything else? Gospel-centered or biblical sermons. What else? Support, okay, that's good. I read some different polls and looked at those, and those are all similar answers. Bible-based sermons, a good service that's not too long. was kind of... a place for kids, and that wasn't specific enough about a place for kids to learn in their learning age, but so it was split. You couldn't see the difference if it was that or if it was just a place for kids to like just disappear for a little bit. Place for kids, style of worship, conveniences, right? So on the list of different polls, so parking close or a lot of interesting things. A lot of interesting things. And what's fascinating about that If you ask that question and you think about it, if you were really being honest and you thought about, you know, when I come to church, I expect X to happen. You know, I expect the guitar players to know how the chords they're playing. You know, I expect somebody to welcome me when I come to the door. I expect the coffee tastes good. And those are all like weird, like frugal things. But if you're being honest and you stop and think about when you, as you're coming to church, you've got these expectations in your mind. Like when I show up, I really want X to happen, right? Right? Okay. So I'm saying that, all right? And I just want you to be honest in your heart, because that's where I was torn, because I didn't want people to start raising hands and saying, yeah, I just care about the coffee. I don't want anybody to say that, because I know that's not really true. But if we were to ask, what commands does God give in his word for Christians? You guys could give me a list, like, love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Love your neighbors yourself, right? Make disciples. Care for the orphan or the widow. Care for needs. Share the gospel. Bear one another's burdens, right? So then, the question is, what list is more important? Obviously, second list, you got smart people, you know. Yes, the second list is more important. But is that what you expect when you come to church? Is that what you expect when you say, I'm going to church, and I'm expecting the body to bear my burdens with me. I expect them to train me to make disciples. Is that what you're thinking when you're getting dressed and wrestling the kids and trying not to be frustrated and getting in the minivan and coming to church? Is that what you're thinking about? Not most of the time, right? For being honest, just be honest. Now, the first list, having a nice space, having music that's pleasant, all those things can help support the second list, right? Because you can come, we can train, and we can be moved, and we can experience God, and it can remind us how much we love him, and it can inspire us to love others. I mean, all those things can help. The second list can help the first list. But we have to remember that the second list is more important. And thinking about that, it really comes back to our understanding of what church is, what church is supposed to be. Not even what we expect church to be, but what the Bible says it's supposed to be. And I think that most of us have a fundamentally flawed interpretation of what church is. So we're going to talk about it. Now, we just went through Mark, right? If you guys are aware of this, we just went through the entire book of Mark. And right in the middle, you guys remember this like transition. And Jesus had taken his disciples up to Caesarea Philippi and took them up to this pagan worship area. And he asked them, you know, who do the people say that I am? And they taught, you know, Elijah and the prophet. And, okay, who do you say I am? You are the Christ, the Messiah, you're the promised one. And the backdrop of all these pagan people is like, yes, okay, so I'm not like all these other false gods, these false idols. No, I'm the Messiah. Great. And in that moment, as Jesus transitions from who he is, the Messiah, to why he's come, he points to what is about to happen. Like everything begins to shift and focus on his ministry to the cross and the ministry that he is bestowing upon his disciples, all those that follow him, then and today. So we look at Matthew chapter 16. There's a verse right in the middle of this. This is Matthew's version of that same instance at Caesarea Philippi. And he says, blessed are you, Simon, right? And he says in verse 18, I tell you, you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Now, there's some very interesting stuff in that, for sure, whether Peter, Petros, is the rock, and if it correlates to that Aramaic rock, if it's the same thing. But I don't want to focus on that today. What I want to focus on is the statement, I will build my church. He tells Peter, yes, you got it. Great answer. And Peter, on you, on this rock, I will build my church. And the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. He is foreshadowing the ministry that he is going to bestow upon his disciples then and now. It's us. He says, I'm going to build my church. What is he building? A building? No. Absolutely not. He's building a people, right? He's building a body of believers that he calls his bride, the church universal. Now, this word is very interesting because the word there in the Greek is ekklesia, and if you've been in church, you've probably heard that word before. But ekklesia, I think we have not wrongly translated the word. We've transliterated, right? We've come up with a term, and we say church, but the word actually means a gathering of called out people. That's what the word means. I mean, actually, it's two Greek words. They're compounded. Ek, which is called out, right? Or out of, and then kaleo, which is called, to be called. So the word literally means ones who have been called out. Ones, people. And it's public assembly, right? So this word is used throughout the Bible, and it's not specifically a Christian word. It's not specific to the people who follow Christ. It's many times you have a gathering of people. The term is used in the Old Testament to talk about Israel as the church. That's how the King James Version actually translates it as this ecclesia. But they're not a church; they're a people. And there's other times that the word is used outside of the Bible as well that talks about this gathering, people who've come with a common purpose into the town hall, into the public space, and they've come with a common cause, and they've come out of their homes. They're called out of their homes. They're called out from wherever they are to come together for some common purpose. And so from the Christian perspective, Jesus says, I will build my church. It's basically saying, I'm going to call us out. I'm going to call you out to come together, to be unified and carry on my ministry, the message, the gospel, the truth of eternal life and salvation. So this passage is really a great place to start the conversation because this is the only place in the gospels, it's one of only two times when Jesus uses this term and talks about the church. The other time is when he's dealing with in Matthew 18, he's dealing with those who have sinned against you, and he says, bring them before the church, but it's the same term. Bring them before those who are called out. Bring them before the fellow believers. Bring them before those that are with you to expose the sin. And so the only two times it's used, right, Jesus uses it here. He's not talking about a place. He's not talking about a building. It's a term used over 100 times, 114 times specifically, in the New Testament, and never once does it refer to a place that people go to. Acts 7:38 talks about the assembled Israelites. Acts 19:32 talks about Gentiles gathered in Ephesus. 1 Corinthians 10:32 talks about the whole body of believers. So when Jesus says, I will build my church, he is not talking about building a building. He is talking about building a people. And just like in the video that we just watched, right? The stained glass is not going to sing praises. The walls are not going to preach the gospel. But sometimes we get caught up in terms that have been used for so long that we forget that there is a right way to understand it and to view it. And I think that it's important for us to come back to God's word and sometimes maybe correct mistakes that have been dug into our traditions. So let me turn real quick. Let's turn to Ephesians. Read one more passage. Ephesians 2. Just because I want you to see that I'm not just making this up, right? I didn't just like decide that I was going to interpret God's word this way. Georgia Electric Power Company. All right, hang on. Where is it in here? Did y'all do that Bible drill? All right, here we go. Ephesians chapter 2, verses 20 through 22. Well, I'll just start from verse 19. So then you are no longer strangers and aliens, but you are fellow citizens with the saints and members of the household of God, built on the foundation of the apostles and prophets, Christ Jesus himself being the cornerstone, and whom the whole structure, being joined together, grows into a holy temple in the Lord. In him you are also being built together into a dwelling place for God by the Spirit. And I love that because it's using the metaphor of building a building, but it's not a building, right? And here's something that's really, really fascinating about this, when you think about this. So he's talking about the temple of God, like the place where God will dwell. And he's taking from Psalm 22:3 that God inhabits the praises of his people. He dwells on the praises of his people. But we know from multiple places, when Stephen is standing there, he's being stoned, and he's preaching to them before he's being stoned, he says, God is not a God who will be confined by four walls. And he's drawing from the prophet Isaiah in chapter 61. He's saying, you can't confine God to a building. That's not his intent. I mean, his footstool is the earth. I mean, he spreads out into the heavens. You can't box him in. He's not meant to be boxed in. It's not that his goal is not to have a place. His goal is to have a people. Right, and here, right, in this metaphor, this analogy of the structure being built together, this is really interesting. Okay, so even before Israel had a place to worship, right, before the tabernacle, they were ecclesia, they were this body, this group, this people, and then God gave them this instruction, and said, build a tabernacle. So it's like, see, God wants to have a building. He told them to build a building. Now, hang on, wait, follow me. So they have this dedication. In Leviticus 9:24, and the storm happens and fire falls, right, and it covers the Holy of Holies, and the presence of God is there, right? And it's why they fall on their face and they worship him. It's amazing. And then David wants to build an official physical temple that's permanent, and he's not allowed to. His son Solomon does, builds the temple, and when they dedicate it, same thing happens. The storm rages, the winds blow, and fire falls, boom, consumes the altar. And the presence of God manifests there. And in that moment, that's in First Chronicles 7:1-4. In that dedication moment, God makes his presence known. Listen, the second temple is built. There's no dedication. There's no fire that falls. The next time the fire falls is when this temple is dedicated at Pentecost. You go back and look at it. In Acts 2, what does it say? It says, the storm raged and a fire was found on their heads like tongues of fire. The fire fell. The Holy Spirit consumed them. And what happened? It went nuts, crazy. They started, said, speaking in tongues. They were speaking in languages. And all these people were like, man, that dude's speaking in Spanish. That dude's speaking in Russian. I don't know if they're actually Spanish or Russian speaking there, but they're just Italian. They're all speaking all these different languages. And they're like, I can understand him in my language, but I know he doesn't speak my language. What is happening here? And all people over here are like, man, I just think they're drunk. I was like, because that's what people look like when they're drunk. They act crazy. And that's because something had changed in them. It was God dedicating his dwelling place in us. So when Paul talks about building this up, this whole story, being joined together, the holy temple of the Lord, this is what Paul talks about in 1 Corinthians 2. We are now the temple of God. And so when we cry out in repentance and say, God, save me, I need you. I am a sinner. I need your grace. I come to you. I place my faith and trust in you. We are consumed by his fire. The Holy Spirit comes into our hearts, and we become the temple of God. Not a building. Not a place. You. Why is this important? Why am I talking about this? Because if we see the church as a place we go, we will miss the true calling of a people that goes. We are the church. And it's great to have a place to meet. It's great, for sure, right? But here's three reasons why this is important. Three reasons why I'm talking about this. Number one, a church as a place is not biblical. It's just not. And to think of church, and all right, so let me just go ahead and say this. I'm gonna push a little button, all right? I've had to rethink this. I've had to retrain myself, and this may be hard for some of you, but I'm just going to put it out there, all right? Nobody's going to hell if you continue to do this. It's not a sin to keep doing this. I'm just putting it out there, okay? But some of you have probably said recently, let's go to church, right? Probably, okay? How does that work? The first century church, that wouldn't have made sense to them. Let's go to church. Oh, wait, we're gathering. We're hanging out together. You want to be at my house or your house? What do you want to do? It's like, no, let's go to church. I don't understand what you mean, to church. You want to be the church? Let's go be the church. So we have built into our brains this idea that the church is a place, but that's not biblical. It's not biblical. And I've said this, and Brian makes fun of me all the time, because I'll do all the time. It's like, hey, is that stepladder at the church? You mean the building? I'm like, yes. I do it all the time. Because it's like ingrained in me. I mean, it's like how I've always thought of it. And to come back and to reevaluate and correct something that is not biblical is important. And even go back to the Old Testament, right? When people of God was set apart long before he ever called them to build the dwelling place for him. And the tabernacle and then the temple. All of those things, by the way, the temple and the tabernacle, they all pointed to something greater, which was in Christ. And see, New Testament, when we get to Jesus and he becomes the final sacrifice, you don't need the temple anymore, because we are now the temple of God. Jesus begins to point out the fallacy of the Pharisees as they're still holding on to these traditions. And he tells them, we looked at this in Mark too. He says, look, you have created extra laws. You have created these extra rules that are not God's rules. And it wasn't that they were necessarily bad. It wasn't that what they were saying was wrong. It's just that they put more weight and importance on the man-made rules and the man-made laws than what God wrote in his word. And that's the point. If changes to traditional church rub you so negatively that you would rather have certain traditions over truly worshiping God, then church as a place has become so ingrained in you that you're missing what the Bible says it's supposed to be. We are the church. And you can't allow traditions, you can't allow sacred cows. I mean, listen, I grew up in church where you couldn't move the podium without special permission from some deacon board. I mean, there was like these things were sacred. It was like, why? I mean, they become idols. The building, the church building, has in many ways, in many places, become an idol that in and of itself takes over the worship. And that's exactly what Jesus was pointing out to the Pharisees. Like, you've made up rules, you've made up laws, and that's more important to you than what God's word says. Fix that. All right. So that's the first reason why it's important, because it's not biblical. And if this is our source for what is authoritative, then we come back to that. And he says that it's not a place to go, it's a people that go. So that's why we're talking about it. Number two. Church as a place is consumer-centric. See, in life we compartmentalize things, right? We say, this is where I go to school, this is where I go to work, this is where I live, this is where I get my hair cut, this is where I shop for groceries, this is where I go to church, right? And now it's just one more place that's where you box things in, right? You don't do work at school. Right? You try not to take work at home, right? You compartmentalize things in your life. We'll do the same thing with church. It's like, I don't take church to work. I don't take church to school because I go to church for church. And what happens then is like we were talking about earlier, you come to church and you expect things to be a certain way for you. Amen. And the whole experience of what church is supposed to be for you becomes very consumer-centric. And then, because you see church as a place, it's the place you go to meet God. It's the place where you worship God. It's the place where you experience God. It's the place to show that we love God, and it's just that place and nowhere else. Is church something you do, or is it something you are? we are the church, then it points back to our life and our thoughts and our deeds and our words and our actions. We can come here and we can get inside these walls and be away from all the other things we have going on and all the other people we interact with, and we can box it in right here, and it's just about whether we liked the service that week or we didn't, or we liked the songs that were chosen that week or we didn't, and it becomes just about us and whether our needs were met and whether our expectations were met, and it's consumer-centric because we see church as a place, it's a part of our compartmentalized world. And it's just something we do. Which leads us to the third one. Seeing church as a place is very restrictive. Because if you see a church as the place where all the God things happen, then you see the church as the place that should do all the God things for you. This is where ministry happens. This is where the gospel is shared. This is where you experience God. And so you will invite people to come to church with you. You'll invite people to come hear the gospel. You'll invite people to experience God. And that's great. Please invite people. Please come for that, right? But if you're doing that because you expect the leadership here to do what you're supposed to be doing outside these walls, then the church as a place has become very restrictive in your mindset. It's actually taken away, it's taken away your responsibility. You're saying the church is where ministry happens as a place, so that I don't have to do ministry outside of the church as a place. No, that's not. I mean, Ephesians 4 is very clear that the role of the leadership is not to do your work for you. In fact, it says, equip the saints, what? So that they do the work of ministry. We're supposed to be training you, firing you up, getting you ready to go outside of these walls. That's why when you go to churches, especially old Southern Baptist Church, it was great. They had a little sign that says, you're entering the mission field, right? I grew up in the church, had a little sign that says, you're entering the mission field. And I was like, cool, you know. And that's the last I thought of it, right? Because, I mean, unless I was going to Africa, I mean, what really is the mission field outside the church parking lot? Because now I'm on church parking lot. Now we can talk about God, right? Now this is where ministry happens. No. It's a very modern idea. Yes, there's always been buildings. There's nothing wrong with buildings. There's nothing wrong with having a place. But if the place is where you think ministry happens, if the place is where you think the gospel is shared, I think you would be shocked to see that the places where the gospel is thriving, where lives are changing, where the church is growing, are places where they don't have buildings. And they don't have sound systems. They don't have TV with lyrics for those songs they don't know. Because all over the world, churches are thriving, meeting under a tree, or in someone's home, or on the street, or in a basement compartment with a single light and shared pages of a Bible, because they only have one copy. And it's exploding. But here, we're doing it wrong. Church is not a place to go. Church is a people that goes. What are we going to do about it? So, we want to change some things around. And little things, like in the service, we're not going to sing at the beginning for a while. Why? Because we don't want to entertain you as a precursor to a sermon that maybe is good, maybe isn't. Who knows? We want you to respond to God's love appropriately. And we've seen in different things that we've done. And in fact, if you actually look and study, and I've said this for years, and it's irritating to myself that we're just now trying this. almost every single time people fall on their face and worship God, it's after God speaks. It's after he moves. And we've seen it. We've been in environments where just something radical happens, and now we want to sing, except that's not in the service order. So we don't. So we're changing it. So that you can hear from God and hopefully the Holy Spirit's moving in your heart, and then you can respond to God appropriately. And it's not about us just trying to warm you up. It's not supposed to be that way. If church is about the people more than it is about the place, then we want to be more about you. And so we're going to try some things. We're going to do some things different just to try to be around you more often. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to break bread together. Now, there are already some things on the calendar that you guys know about. If you're women, there's Ladies Night Out on November 9th. Thank you. At 6:30. Every woman here should come. Now, if you don't come, anybody mad at you? No. That's fine. You got other stuff going on. You don't have to be here. Nobody's pressuring you. Don't feel guilty. It's okay. But it's available. You want to meet some people. You want to be around women who can encourage you and pray with you. Come. Men. We're starting to meet monthly. And we're going to start on Friday night. And we're doing our next meeting on October 26th. Here at 6:30. You don't have to come. We'd love to hang out with you. We'd love to pray with you and encourage you and hear what's going on in your life. And as we learned the last time we met, what's going on in your life is probably going on in everyone else's too. You just don't know it. Let's talk about it. So come hang out with us. Those things we've been doing. We started this past year doing connection lunches because I wanted to hang out and meet new people that were in the church. And so we have a connection lunch that's coming up in a couple weeks, October 21st. So it's just anybody new that wants to meet me or talk about the church or hear my story, and we just sit around, eat food, and enjoy each other's company. That's happening October 21st. So if you're new and you want to do that, that's great. In November, though, we're gonna cater lunch for everybody. Anyone. This is not potluck, right? This is if you want to come hang out and just be around some people, everybody's gonna eat lunch. And maybe you've got kids and need to take a nap, maybe you can't come. That's okay. Nobody's pressuring you to do this. But we thought, hey, we love going to eat lunch with people after church, and people are always doing that. And what if we just created an environment where we could just do it ourselves? So we're gonna have food. You're welcome to hang out with us. We'll tell you more about that, and you can sign up for that just so we don't end up with too little food. But we'll pull all the chairs out. We'll set up tables. We'll just hang out with each other. And if it works, we'll do it a lot. We'll see. Because church can't just be about coming and sitting here and taking something in and thinking that it's just this. It's not. And as we talk about this and dig a little more into that question, what is the church, over the next couple weeks, and I really encourage you to come back, we're going to see that there's a lot more to it. It's really exciting. It can really be a blessing. So that's what we're going to start to do. And it's just a taste. We will continue to try to push you, challenge you, help you, support you, pray for you, do everything that we can so that you feel fueled up, inspired, ready to go outside these walls and be the church. Let's pray. Father, we need more churches, not buildings, groups of people who live out their love for you together, to each other, for each other, in their workplaces, in their homes, in their neighborhoods. We need more people to recognize that they are the church everywhere they go, representing their faith in you. So may it be true in everything that we say and everything that we do. Church is not a place to go. It is a people that goes. May you send us out to be what you've called us to be. We pray that.